Dusty Tomes Audiobooks and Spoken Realms present Mary Wollstonecraft Godwin by Elizabeth Robbins Pennell, 1885, narrated by Joseph Tabler, published by W. H. Allen in London. Preface. Comparatively little has been written about the life of Mary Wollstonecraft Godwin. The two chief authorities upon the subject are William Godwin and Mr. C. Kegan Paul. In writing the following biography, I have relied chiefly upon the memoir written by the former and the life of Godwin, and prefatory memoir to the Letters to Imlay of the latter. I have endeavored to supplement the facts recorded in these books by a careful analysis of Mary Wollstonecraft Godwin's writings and study of the period in which she lived. I must here express my thanks to Dr. Richard Garnett and to Mr. C. Kegan Paul for the kind assistance they have given me in my work. To the first named of these gentlemen, I am indebted for the loan of a manuscript containing some particulars of Mary Wollstonecraft Godwin's last illness, which have never yet appeared in print, and to the latter for the gift as well as the loan of several important books. E.R.P. Mary Wollstonecraft Godwin. Introduction. Few women have worked so faithfully for the cause of humanity as Mary Wollstonecraft Godwin, and few have been the objects of such censure. She devoted herself to the relief of her suffering fellow beings with the ardor of a St. Vincent de Paul, and in return was considered by them a moral scourge of God. Because she had the courage to express opinions new to her generation and the independence to live according to her own standard of right and wrong, she was denounced as another Messalina. The young were bidden not to read her books, and the more mature warned not to follow her example, the miseries she endured being declared the just retribution of her actions. Indeed, the infamy attached to her name is almost incredible in the present age, when new theories are more patiently criticized, and when purity of motive has been accepted as the vindication of at least one well-known breach of social laws. The malignant attacks made upon her character since her death have been too widely known to be ignored. But the life which follows may serve for their refutation. As a rule, the notices which were published after she was dead were harsher and more uncompromising than those written during her lifetime. There were happily one or two exceptions. The writer of her obituary in the monthly magazine for September 1797 speaks of her in terms of unlimited admiration, but it is more than probable that it was written by a personal friend. A year later, the same magazine, in its semi-annual retrospective of British literature, expressed somewhat altered opinions. The notice in the Gentleman's Magazine for October 1797, the month after her death, was friendly but guarded in its praise. In 1798, Godwin published his memoir of Mary Wollstonecraft, together with her posthumous writings. He hoped, no doubt, by a clear statement of the principal incidents of her life to moderate the popular feeling against her. But he was the last person to have undertaken the task. Outside the small circle of friends and sympathizers who really loved him, he was by no means popular. There were some who even seemed to think that the greatest hardship of Mary's life was to have been his wife. Thus Roscoe, after reading the memoir, expressed the sentiments it aroused in him in the following lines. "Hard was thy fate in all the senses of life, as daughter, sister, mother, friend, and wife. But harder still thy fate in death we own, thus mourned by Godwin with a heart of stone." Moreover, Godwin's views about marriage, as set forth in his Political Justice, were held in such abhorrence that the fact that he approved of Mary's conduct was reason enough for the multitude to disapprove of it. His book, therefore, was not a success as far as Mary's reputation was concerned.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.